Whilst the conversation today is around Wayland and X11, this was not always the case. For a very short period, for a single distro project, really, it was a single distro project, there was a third party, that being Mir, or Mir. I've heard people say both of them. I don't actually know which is the correct pronunciation, but it also frankly doesn't matter. This was first announced in March of 2013. Now keep in mind the Ubuntu timeline here. This was 2 years into the swap from GNOME 2 to the Unity desktop. This was a very weird time for Canonical where they, unlike today, were super focused on the consumer space and wanted to turn Ubuntu into the everything OS with a unified desktop. That's why it was called Unity. They wanted you to run the same operating system, the same desktop across your desktop PC, your TV, your tablet, and your phone. And in retrospect, we can see how this turned out, but I feel like a part of the reason this failed so badly is because of the way they handled Mir. Now, whilst Mir did leave the limelight, it didn't stop being used, and even till today, Canonical is still using Mir in embedded use cases, but not in the same context they were back then. Today, it just exists as another Wayland compositor library, and as such, there are a couple of community projects built off of Mir as well. A good example is Niri, which is a scrollable window manager. Like any good open source project, there are random commits from unaffiliated people here and there, but this is still primarily being developed by Canonical employees, primarily Matthew Kosarek, Christopher James Halls Rogers, and Alan Griffiths, all of Canonical. Now, 2013 is a really weird time to start Mir, because do you know when Wayland first started? That was 2008. Now, obviously back in 2008, but even by 2013, the regular user didn't really care about Wayland. If you were following Linux news, you'd probably heard of it by that point, but you probably weren't running it. Even Fedora, one of the very first distros to adopt Wayland by default, even for them, it was still 3 years too early. That doesn't mean there wasn't interest in Wayland. Whilst the users didn't have interest, the developers, they were very excited. So the obvious question then is, why make Mir instead of building off of Wayland? And here's the funny thing about Wayland. When Unity was first announced, Mark Shuttleworth put out Unity on Wayland. That was going to be the plan. We'd like to embrace Wayland early, as much of the work we're doing on uTouch and other input systems will be relevant for Wayland and is an area we can make a useful contribution to the project. We're confident we'll be able to retain the ability to run X applications in a compatibility mode, so this is not a transition that needs to reset the world of desktop-free software. That being, obviously, X Wayland. There is another thing for Mir, that being called X Mir. Timeframes are difficult. I'm sure we could deliver something in 6 months, but I think a year is more realistic for the first images that will be widely useful in our community. I'd love to be proven conservative on that, but I suspect it's more likely to err the other way. It might take 4 or more years to really move the ecosystem. Progress on Wayland itself is sufficient for me to be confident that no other initiative could outrun it, especially if we deliver things like Unity and uTouch with it, and also if we make an early public statement in support of the project, which this is. We considered and spoke with several proprietary options on the basis they might be persuaded to open source their work for a new push, and we evaluated the cost of building a new display manager informed by the lessons learned in Wayland. We came to the conclusion that any such effort would only create a hard split in the world which wasn't worth the cost of having it. There are issues with Wayland, but they seem to be solvable. We'd rather be part of solving them than chasing a better alternative. So Wayland, it is. There is no clearer way to say that Wayland was going to be the direction for Unity. at least in 2010. Then we move to 2013. Canonical's decision to build its own unique display server instead of creating an implementation of the already mature Wayland protocol. It's really funny to see Wayland being called mature in 2013. Has generated controversy in the broader Linux community. Critics argue the duplication of effort and the risk of fragmentation are detrimental to the platform. Canonical claims that it simply couldn't make Wayland meet Ubuntu's needs. What were those needs, you might ask? Well, luckily we have an archive of the Mer part of the Ubuntu Wiki. And this has a section called Motivation. Why Mer? Why not Wayland / Western? First, we are aiming for a more extensible input event handling that takes future developments like 3D input devices, e.g. Leap Motion, into account. With respect to mobile use cases, we think the handling of input methods should be reflected in the display server protocol too. As another example, we consider the shell integration parts of the protocol as privileged, and we'd rather avoid having any sort of shell behavior defined in the client-facing protocol. Here we have an article from Veronix. Upstream X/ Wayland developers bash Canonical. Mer. Christian, the creator of Wayland/ Western, has posted to his Google Plus page, this is how you know it took place in 2013, about the Canonical Mer announcement. And that post is sadly another thing that didn't get archived properly. There are archives of it, but the archives link to a white page, so I can't actually see the post. Luckily, we have Daniel's post here though. The best part is the input bit of the rationale is totally wrong. There's no way for clients to get another client's input, short of mapping a full screen transparent window and convincing the compositor to not decorate it. There also aren't any grabs, which I could have told them if anyone involved ever bothered to talk to anyone upstream. I'm not worried about Wayland's future at all. I'm just irritated that this means more work for us. More work for upstream developers, more work for toolkits, more work for hardware vendors, and years of explaining that most of the page explaining that Mer had to be created because Wayland was A, hugely deficient, and B, unfixable, was total bullshit. And everyone's favorite person, Lennart Pottering of Systemd and Pulse Audio fame. I am sure Mer is going to be a project with a fantastic future, just like Bazaar, or Upstart, or Project Harmony before it. These are projects that many of you probably never heard of before. Most version control nowadays is done with Git, but Canonical wanted a piece of the pie and made GNU Bazaar. Now, Bazaar did see some level of use, but I wouldn't be surprised if you've never interacted with it. Upstart was an init system made by Canonical, and we know how that's gone with every distro running systemd now. And Project Harmony sounds nice. It was all about creating contributor license agreements, which are basically a document you sign in a free software project to basically defeat the point of having the license there because they usually supersede the terms of the license. Now, this was shortly followed by a second Phronix article, a note to Canonical, don't piss on Wayland. This focused on a conversation in the Wayland IRC where Christian, David Ehrlich, Daniel Stone, and other people involved in Wayland were basically just railing on Canonical, and the one Canonical person involved in the chat, Chris Halls Rogers. And Chris decided to make a joke. It's Canonical's turn to pull a systemd. Christian was quick to let the Canonical developer know he doesn't agree with Mer and that the technical reasons on the Mer page just don't add up. In particular, everything about input that the Ubuntu developers say as shortcomings with Wayland. Christian added, don't go out and tell the whole world how Wayland is broken and has all X's input problems. That's what pisses me off. You can do whatever you want and you don't need my permission, but don't piss on Wayland in the process. And another developer chimed in to say, if you look at the Mer example, it's scary. It doesn't seem to have the notion of atomic commit or frame synchronization. There is a bunch of U-sleep in them with bogus value to supposedly do 60 FPS. If your goal is to make a new desktop protocol that is going to be adopted by developers, the best strategy, at least a strategy that's pretty recommended, is don't annoy the people that are already running the main project. That is both X and Wayland, because that's kind of most of the people doing the desktop things on Linux. Now, the documentation and the technical issues were not the only problem. There was also a debacle over the licensing. There was confusion why it was using the GPL v3 license over MIT like Xorg and Wayland, but the bigger problem was the inclusion, once again, because we had that whole Project Harmony thing, of a contributor license agreement. Canonical CLA is pretty simple. In essence, it grants Canonical the right to use, modify, and distribute your code, and grants Canonical a patent license under any patents you own that may cover the code in question. But most importantly, it grants Canonical the right to re-license your contribution under their choice of license. This means that despite not being the sole copyright holder, Canonical are free to re-license your code under a proprietary license. This effectively made it having a GPL v3 license attached to it completely null and void. And the issue wasn't being able to relicense. That's what you can do with Wayland and you can do with X11 and all of these other MIT projects. The issue was the asymmetry of the rights. They could relicense, but you couldn't. These concerns were also echoed by the then director of the Software Freedom Conservancy, Bradley Kuhn. Frankly, I think we see Canonical doing a lot of things in desperation in the last 12 months. That's not a good sign for them, and the developers I've been seeing leaving in Exodus gives me the impression there's no longer a good place to work for developers. I suspect we don't need to worry about what Canonical is doing anymore. I've generally just been ignoring them. That's a fine thing to say, but MER was affecting things outside of Ubuntu, outside of Canonical. At this point, we were 5 years into Wayland. And if we went down the MER route as well, now desktops we need to care about MER, toolkits we need to care about MER. And here we have a post about Kwin that didn't really care about MER. Does MER affect us? Yes, obviously. Because of MER, I have to write this blog post. Wayland developers have to get the FUD out of the MER documentation. It's creating tension and it harms the development. We will have to face again and again the question of whether Wayland is better or not. So yes, it affects us and I'm not happy about it. Will Kwin support MER? No. MER is currently a one distribution only solution and any adjustments would be a distro specific. We do not accept patches to support one downstream. If there are downstream specific patches, they should be applied downstream. This means at the current time, there is no way to add support, and even if someone would implement support for Kwin on Ubuntu, I would veto the patches as we don't accept distro specific code. Here's a post about LightDM, which at the time was the greeter being used on KDE, and LightDM was getting heavy sponsorship from Canonical, so it put them into this weird situation where, should we add support for MER? Do we need to add support for MER? Like, what's the deal with this sponsorship? How far does this actually go? And we also had a take from Matthias Klassen of GNOME. So far, we've silently assumed that Wayland is the future display system on Linux, and that we'll get to using it eventually. The recent MER announcement makes it a bit more urgent that we put our weight behind Wayland and help it reach its full potential. Doing this also fits our mandate from last Guardec to set stronger technical directions. Not only were they anti-MER and didn't want to support it, but MER existing spurred them on to get Wayland supported faster. Now, theoretically, Canonical could have just said, we're Canonical, we have Ubuntu, we are massive, we don't really need to care what the rest of you desktops are doing, you're gonna have to follow suit. And they probably could have done so, but do you know who they can't bully around? They can't bully around Intel, and Intel didn't want to deal with them. Intel reverts plans, will not support Ubuntu's XMER. As I mentioned earlier, XMER is basically X-Wayland, but running X11 applications on MER. We do not condone or support Canonical in the course of action they have chosen, and will not carry ex-mer patches upstream. So if they wanted to go down this route, they would now need to start shipping custom patches for the driver just to have basic features working. And the rest since then is basically history. Come the release of 1804, Canonical said, "We're done with this whole Unity convergence thing, and I guess this whole mer thing just isn't really gonna work out." Now, the funny thing about mer is they had actually started turning it into a Wayland compositor library before dropping Unity. Back in 2017, that seems to be the earliest reference to Wayland in the codebase. But in the Unity project, they'd been sitting around not dealing with Wayland for a very long time, so they were very, very far behind where GNOME was at that point. And yes, 2018 Wayland still needed a lot of work, and they probably could have caught up. But they're also leaving this whole convergence thing and didn't really see the value in having a desktop anymore, and it just made more sense to go back to the thing that wasn't just a one distro solution. Mer was a very weird time on the Linux desktop, and I don't see something like that ever happening again. It wasn't just the matter of making a new desktop environment. That's one thing, right? But trying to do that with a whole new desktop API at the same time, that was kind of a recipe for disaster if you weren't doing it exactly the way that other people wanted it to be done. But what do you think? Were you there at the time? If you were there at the time, let me know what your thoughts were when you saw all this going down. I would love to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out our Patreon, Scrubs, LiberaPay, linked in the description down below. That's gonna be it for me, and one day I'll make an Arkan video. What's this?